Today, we are going over how to write a dispute letter that gets results. And we're doing this by going over the checklist. So you see, I've broken down all of my letters that have resulted in extreme deletions and credit score increases, and each of them meet the requirements in this checklist. We're going to go over all six steps, and I'll show you exactly what to include in your dispute letters to get the maximum results in the least amount of time. Now, make sure you stay to the end to find out one of my top three tactics for getting results. So here is our example letter, and most of this is taken from, just like I mentioned, my top letters that have resulted in extreme results. And as you can see, there are highlighted sections, and we're going to match these to the actual checklist. So take a look at the checklist. We have opener, reason, follow-up, identification, method, and frequency. And if you take a look at the actual letter, you're going to see that I've highlighted three different sentences. So just real quick, we have Bobby McBobness, we have his information, including date of birth and social, as well as the bureau. Now, additionally, you can throw in the date on there, but that's pretty straightforward, so I did not include that. So look at the three sentences that I've highlighted. So take a look at opener. The opener says it is required to have a request for investigation, reason for investigation, request for a new credit report, and any additional information. So let's go find this on the actual letter. As you can see, sentence number one is highlighted. It says, I don't believe that there's been an actual investigation on these accounts and you failed to furnish any documentation that proves that they're reported correctly. Because of this, I need for you to perform an independent investigation and blah, 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 blah. Jump to that last sentence in the first paragraph. I'd like a new report reflecting these changes requested below. And then my second paragraph is additional information. So as you can see, I've requested my investigation. I've given a reason for the investigation because I don't believe that they even did an investigation and I'd like an independent one. I've asked for my new report and I provided additional information that I'm getting really frustrated because they keep telling me that I'm wrong when I'm sending the information taken directly from the credit report. You see how simple that is? So when you know exactly what to write, it makes it so much easier to target your results, all right? So let's go to the next step. So on the bottom part of the letter, we have the actual accounts that we are disputing. Take a look at the reason checklist. It says we need the action, justifier, reason, and outcome, right? So just as a side note there, I do have a video that's going to be linked at the very end of this video, and it's for the dispute letter magic, where we're going to go into the science behind each part of this formula, all right? And it actually resulted in over 20,000 deletions in 2020. So if you want to check that out, make sure you wait to the end of the video and click on it on the end screen. So let's go back to this. As you can see, just as the top part of the letter, we have things that are highlighted. So we need the action, justifier, reason, and outcome, right? So for capital one, we're saying delete for inaccuracy because the balance is reported as $22, $25, and $29. I mean, obviously those are three totally different numbers, right? And these are actual reasons taken directly from letters that I've sent out. These are not made up, okay? So delete for capital one is going to be our action. Because it's a justifier, the reason is balance is reported as 22, 25, and 29. Now, outcome is optional. Outcome, I normally only use outcome for late payments. And you're going to see that on the Discover account. So now we have an unknown collection and I'm seeing delete, which is the action for false reporting because the justifier, no furnisher name or address reports, and that is the reason. And you failed to correct this from my first dispute. That's everything that you need to write. There's no additional information that's required, okay? Discover, remove, that's the action, the late payment on June 2020 because justifier. It's reported as 30 days late, but Equifax and TransUnion both report that I paid on time. That's the reason. Update the status to reflect that I paid on time. That is the outcome. That's what I want them to do. I told them why I'm disputing it, what I want them to do, which is remove it, and what the outcome should be, that I want them to correct something, okay? Now, let's look at our last one, XYZ apartment collection 12345. Stop reporting, that's the action, this account because, that's a justifier, I disputed this on the date of my first dispute, and the notice of dispute was not entered. That's my reason. Within the 30-day time period. Delete for violation of Section 623. Now, I did tell you that I was going to let you know one of my top three tactics for removing negative items, and that's a little bit of a hint right there. All right, so let's go to the next step. Now you see that we have met all the requirements for the reasons, the requirements for the opener, and let's check out the other things that you need to know about to get your results. Let's jump over to identification. With every single letter, every single time they go out the door, you should be sending a copy of your identification, license or military or passport, social security card or W-2 or something that has your full number listed on it, 1234567 89, right? And proof of address, and know your identification, meaning your license, your state ID, your passport, whatever, that's not proof of address. A birth certificate cannot be used, all right? You're talking about utility bill or cell phone bill or pay stub or bank statement, whatever. Those are proof of address every single time, okay? I see this in the comments all the time. Do I have to send this out every single time? Yes, you do, my friend. Yes, you do, okay? Now, follow up. Every single time that you send out your next dispute, always make sure that you are checking for violations before you send out your letter, okay? Violations not in your letter, but you can use these when you're crafting your action plan, because every single letter has its own action plan, right? Now, look at the response analysis. What is Experian or what is Equifax or what is TransUnion sending to you? If they're sending anything, are they saying that they're no longer going to reinvestigate? Are they saying that it's just verified? Are they saying that it's certified as accurate? What are they saying? Because you can use it in your letters when you're crafting your opener, right? Or even your dispute reason. Now, report comparison. What that means is that you need to look at the original report versus your current new report before you write your disputes. The reason, and this is pretty straightforward, but the reason is, number one, you have to make sure that that account is still on the credit report, that it was not deleted. Number two, you're looking for violations. Like I said, it's the notice of dispute on there. Did they certify or verify it as accurate, but did not update the date last reported? Did they change or re-age the date of last activity? So on and so forth. You have to have this new information, right? And then that takes me to the next part. New information. What new information is on your credit report that can be used in your dispute letter? Because that is how you craft factual-based disputes, because you're taking the facts directly from your credit report. Now, method. This needs to go out regular mail or certified, but doesn't have to be certified. I mean, unless you want to spend $21 or more per round, completely up to you. It's not going to make it happen any quicker. I mean, you're paying the post office. You're not paying the bureaus to have a faster, you know, investigation, okay? It needs to be a custom letter. You need to be using factual reasons, and it needs to be consumer authentic if you are a business. Now, frequency. Normally, it's 30 days, right? But if you send something in the middle of the month, they can add 15 days for additional info. Don't send mid-month disputes for the same account, all right? 15 days for, obviously, what we're currently going through. Now, I know that this recently ended, but they are still taking that additional time. And they can take that additional time, and they're going to use it as an excuse for the second thing that we went over, all right? So always be aware of the timing. Okay. And then add 4 days for that mail sending. All right. And that's really useful if you are not sending out certified mail. Just count 4 days. They should have received the letter. Now you can start your counting. Now you know when to pull your next report. Now you know when to send your next round of disputes. All right. So do you have any questions about this? If you don't understand something, you don't understand how to do factual-based disputes, you don't understand what this checklist is for, you don't understand the five-part, you know, formula, whatever it is, post it in the comments and I will answer it. I will help you with whatever it is, okay? Now, as promised, this is one of my top three tactics or my secrets, and it's using the notice of dispute. So one of the fastest ways to get a deletion is to catch the credit bureaus and even collectors in a violation for failure to enter the required notice of dispute. So you see, if it's not reported on the account, like in the comment section within 30 days of receiving the first dispute, it's a violation. I mean, this is actually the magic behind the validation of debt method. Now, I've removed countless countless accounts just using this one violation. It is that important, okay? So always remember that you need to know your violations. And once you know your violations, once you know how an account should be reported, how it should not be reported, then you're putting yourself in the best possible place to get the maximum results in the least amount of time. All right. Now, if you want to learn more, if you want to reach out, then here are two very, very simple links. My740.com will take you to my booking page if you want to see if I can take over your file and do the credit sweep for you. Now, the second link, vault.my740.com, is actually where you can go to get access to the free subscriber hub and a bunch of other awesome resources. Okay. So anywho, now we are at the end of the video. And like I said, this is actually going to be where you can click on the dispute letter magic video, where we go into the science behind the 5-part formula that generated over 20,000 deletions last year. And make sure to hit that like and subscribe if you haven't done so. And I will see you next time. In today's video, we are going to go over what to do when the bureaus won't reinvestigate. And this is part two. You see, we started a brand new FAQ series for credit sweeps. But instead of moving on to the next question, I'm going to give you concrete proof to show you exactly how to deal with this stall tactic. So you're going to see concrete evidence directly from Experian that proves they only take factual disputes seriously. And I'm going to show you exactly how to handle a refusal to investigate any future disputes. Now, these are three of the things, and only three, that we are going to answer. Disputing a blank will change your dispute timing from 30 days to 45. A violation of Section 611 happens when the bureaus refuse to investigate a blank. And the credit bureaus must reinvestigate when you tell them blank, as required by law. Are you ready? Here we have a direct response from Experian where they're stating, we're not going to reinvestigate these accounts. And I actually had to go way back to 2015 to find this in my vault. So let's take a look and break this down. The first section is very, very clear. They reject you simply by stating that the credit granter has verified the accuracy of the account disputed. This is basically telling you that you've reached the end of the road and to go away. Now, Section 611 says they can reject your dispute if you submitted the same dispute. Like, for example, if you said it's unknown or unverified and then sent another dispute saying the same thing, they can reject this for that reason. However, my records show that back in 2015, each dispute letter for this client was factual and taken directly from his credit report, therein making the statement null and void. Now, what you should take away from this is that when you send a new and relevant dispute, they cannot reject based on Section 611 and must actually reinvestigate. Now, here's the proof that using factual disputes is the only way to beat this tactic. It says, if you have additional relevant information that was not presented when you previously disputed the information. In other words, when you send a new dispute reason that has never been used before, they will reinvestigate the disputed info. And here's the big kicker. When you send in templates, you're not specifying the reason the account is inaccurate. You're basically saying that something is unverified and they have to remove it. However, as you can see here, it says that when you tell them specifically why you believe this account or information is inaccurate, they process your dispute as required by law. Now, as I said, I've been searching for this info for years, and you know, I basically totally forgot where I found it, and here it is. The reason you don't want to dispute annual free credit report is because it turns your 30-day investigation into a 45-day investigation. So if you want faster results, make sure to stay away from free annual reports. And here's why so many companies con consumers into signing up. This says that if the bureaus don't receive a response from the furnisher or vendor within the required period, we update the item as you have requested or delete the information. What they're not saying is that the bureaus normally respond, and when they don't, it says they did in their system. And when the creditor or vendor catches up on their paperwork, they can reinsert the accounts even though they were previously deleted. Now, the second to last thing here is what I love about using factual disputes. It says that in some instances, upon reviewing your credit file and any relevant information you have submitted to us, we are able to determine whether the disputed information should be changed or deleted without having to contact the furnisher or the vendor. Imagine sending in a dispute that says this account is unknown, or this account is not mine, or the account is unverified. They will absolutely have to send it over to the furnisher to investigate. However, if you sent in a dispute that proves the balance is reported differently on all three bureaus, or that the required dispute is not entered within the required time frame, or something else that is factual and can be proven in a similar fashion, they can remove the account without contacting them. Which would you rather use? Now, here we're on the last statement that they want to drive home, even though they already said it. Unless you send us additional relevant information to support your claim, we will not reinvestigate this information again. So here's the question. What do we do when we receive one of these responses from the credit bureaus, and how can we try to prevent? See, now we're going to answer that question right now. We've already proven that disputing a free annual credit report will change your dispute timing from 30 days to 45 days, and a violation of Section 611 happens when the bureaus refuse to investigate a duplicate dispute or a same dispute, and the credit bureaus must reinvestigate when you tell them specifically why you believe the information is inaccurate as required by law. So here's the solution, and this is the proactive solution. Now, with your credit report, I recommend one place to consistently pull your report, and I actually use IdentityIQ for my clients, and you can find a discounted link in the description. Don't give the bureaus an additional 15 days just because you want a free annual report. Now, your letter should only state why you're writing it, what you want them to do, what you're disputing, and why you're disputing it. That's it. As far as your reason, the dispute reason should specifically state which element is inaccurate, what you want them to do about it, why it's inaccurate, and what the outcome should be. And that's optional, more for late payments. Now, if this does happen to you, you obviously have to handle this reactively. Now, with Section 611, you can state that they are in violation for refusing to reinvestigate a new factual dispute. And this is the beauty of factual-based dispute systems, because your next dispute is always the next best reason taken directly from the credit report. So that's additional relevant information not having previously been disputed. Excuse me. Now, my recommendation is to use these arguments in your initial paragraph instead of the actual dispute reason, because this is going to save you from spinning in circles with the bureaus. So if you want to see this in action, your paragraph one of your letter can basically say, I'm submitting new and relative information and requesting a reinvestigation of the following accounts per Section 611. And now your dispute reasons, not on your first one, but your second dispute could be, delete this account because I disputed it on date and you did not enter the required notice of dispute by date plus 30, which is a violation of Section 623. Or delete this account because Experian shows a balance of zero, Equifax 2008, and TransUnion 522. As you can see, both of these are specific and factual. So that is how you would handle it reactively. Now, how can you use this to increase your results? I want for you to click on the link in the description to get to this page, the entire presentation actually, and I want you to write down how you can use this solution to optimize your dispute strategy proactively, and how you can increase your chances of deletions or corrections using this solution reactively. Okay. Now, what we went over today was how to handle this when it's verified as accurate, and how to deal with the no reinvestigation, and two different solutions using proactive and reactive approaches. Now, you can check out the next video, which is the 6-part dispute letter checklist, if you haven't done so already. And it basically is going to help you optimize your results using this checklist. That link is also in the description, and I'm probably going to tag this on the end screen. Now that we are at the end and we've done our recap, I want to let you know that you can actually go to vault.my740.com and access a ton of awesome free content in the member vault on the subscriber tab. This will help you learn how to do factual-based disputes, or if this is just not something that you want to do yourself, that's totally cool. You can go to my740.com and schedule a call with me, and I will see if I can help. So that is it for today. Make sure to click on one of the other videos, including the 6-part dispute letter checklist that's going to help you increase. In today's video, we are going over 41 challenges and violations, and it breaks down to 19 things you can dispute on an account, 11 credit bureau violations, and 11 creditor violations. We're starting with the problem, and I'm going to give you the dispute reasons, the bureau violations, creditor violations, and lastly, a quiz, because I want to make sure that you understand this so that you can capitalize and get your results. So I'm going to show you what can easily be disputed on your credit report, how to spot the violations, and like I said, we are going to also have a quiz. All right, so here is the problem. It has always been my professional and tested opinion that the biggest problem is understanding the difference between methods that put a temporary band-aid on and one that gets permanent fixes, right? You see, we don't want to use vague general disputes because yeah, they can get results, but they're normally added back to the credit report quickly. And we don't want that. We do not want that. Do you really want to be checking your credit report every 5 days? And then questioning the existence of an account might actually be very easy for the bureaus or the furnisher to prove. So you don't want to make their job easier for them. And using the same dispute reason each time, like unverified, can get results, but you're more than likely to get a rejection for further investigation. And you can check out the description for the videos on this where I break down why this happens and how to get around this, okay? You wanna beat the system. We're not trying to fool it, we're trying to beat it and get results. And then a one-size-fits-all type of deal for disputes, it normally gets a response that says verified is accurate with no actual investigation, all right? So here's the solution, and it's the only solution. And I am very adamant about this. Factual-based disputes. Challenging other sections of the reporting can prove to be more difficult because, again, we're not making their job easy for the bureaus and furnishers than dealing with the general statements they normally get. What is so special about your disputes? If you can't really answer that, then you're not disputing the right way, okay? This is what I've been doing for each of my clients for 6.5 years and what resulted in over 20,000 deletions in 2020 alone, okay? So now when you're constructing your disputes, my recommendation is keep it real. You can take this with a grain of salt or you can etch it in your Bible, it's up to you. But my recommendation is always to keep your disputes factual. And here's the deal. Factual doesn't mean that it's valid, true, verified, yours, or anything similar. Factual means that you're not trying to flam the bureaus with general disputes, lies, or anything else. Our job is to get legal, permanent results, and the highest scores possible. Well, this is how I do it. My letters include facts, and the info is taken directly from the client's credit report. And when I construct their disputes, I follow very specific formulas. And again, you could find those videos linked in the description. So let's take a look at 19 things that you can check, and these are dispute elements per each account, okay? And some of these may look very, very familiar. So the first thing that we're gonna do is we're gonna check for blatant inaccuracies. And that doesn't always mean that you have 3 different balances or, you know, 3 different past dues or just dates that don't make sense. It's little things that you know to be inaccurate before you ever compare bureaus, okay? So just for an example, is the account number correct? The date the account was established? The high balance? The credit limit? The terms? The frequency of payments? Status? Balance? Past due balance? Should there be a past due balance at all? What about the date last payment? What about the payment amount? First delinquency? Is it reflecting as a charge-off correctly or incorrectly? What about the charge-off amount, the date closed, type of account, responsibility section, like where it says it's authorized user, individual? What about the additional information section? Was the date last, was the notice of dispute entered? Does it say that it was disputed by consumer? Anything that is very similar to that, okay? If not, then you need to use these and capitalize to get your results. Okay, so here are your next steps. So this is what you do with this information. So this is actually where so many consumers get stuck. Let's say that you found something inaccurate on your account. Now what? I'd actually recommend checking out the videos and resources linked in the description to learn more on how to construct your disputes. The 5-part formula generated over 20,000 plus deletions in 2020. How to write your letters to get maximum results, and how to virtually remove any negative item from your credit report. So let's get to the violations. We are going over the credit bureau violations, and there are 11 of them. All right. Willfully and recklessly reporting false info after being notified of the reporting error and failing to investigate or correct the error. And this does include mixed files, inaccurate data status or last activity, inaccurate balance, inaccurate remarks, reinserting or re-reporting a previously deleted item without notifying you within writing within 5 business days of the reinsertion, failure to respond to a dispute within 30 days or 45 days for free annual report, and just a side note here, they can add 15 days in some cases where the creditor or the consumer has provided additional info applicable to the dispute. Reporting a bankruptcy longer than 10 years from the date of adjudication. Reporting a paid tax lien longer than 7 years. And just so you know, if it's unpaid, it can be 10. Failing to update or report the status and or balance of the account that was included in bankruptcy as discharged with the zero balance. Failing to provide, if requested after verification, the method of verification, including the real name, address and phone number of the furnisher within 15 days of your request, reporting a collection or charge-off longer than 7 years from the date of status or last activity, and just so you know, there are exceptions of credit transactions involving more than $150,000, the underwriting of life insurance involving over $150,000, or employment with an annual salary reasonably expected to exceed $75,000 a year. All right, we have a couple of more. Failing to notate that an item on your credit report is under dispute, in other words, notice of dispute, and we just talked about that. And yes, I see that typo right there. Reporting a record of arrest or conviction longer than 7 years, and failure to provide all relevant info to the furnisher when reasonable means to do so are available. Now, let's check out creditor violations, and some of these may look very, very, very familiar. All right. Ignoring an investigation request. And here we go again, willfully and recklessly reporting false info to the credit bureaus after being notified of the reporting error and failing to investigate or correct the error. And again, this includes mixed files, inaccurate data status or last activity, inaccurate balance, and inaccurate remarks. Reporting a charge-off account without reference to the date of status or last activity, and failure to report an account disputed by the consumer as disputed to the credit bureaus. And we got some more here, transferring or selling an account to another company without reporting the transfer and or zero balance. I see this one all the time. Failing to update the status and or balance of an account that was included in bankruptcy as discharged with a zero balance. Falsely reporting the ownership of an account to a non-liable consumer like the spouse, family member, etc. And withholding account data with intent to negatively affect a consumer's credit score. Okay, like the credit limit. I see this all the time with Capital One and Barclays. And guess what? Capital One admitted in testimony during a lawsuit that they do this purposely. Okay, so this is where you're going to see it say high balance is credit limit or credit limit is high balance or anything to that effect. The credit limit should be the credit limit. If the credit limit is $2,500, but the high balance is only $200, that's much different than it saying that the credit limit is the high balance, because the high balance, if it was only $200, that's way less than $2,500. So that means that they're screwing with the utilization. That's why it's so important to understand these things, okay? Failing to delete a hard inquiry that had no permissible purpose, and you can go check out my free inquiry removal webinar that was posted within the last 60 days right here on YouTube. And just so you know, permissible purpose does not mean that they just got shotgunned your application for a dealership, for a vehicle, and that you didn't, get a firm offer, okay? So it's either a firm offer of credit, employment, insurance, court order, child support, things like that. If it does not fall into any of those categories, then it does not belong on your credit report, okay? Reporting a new duplicate account after receiving notice of dispute on the old account. Reporting an account with false reference or without reference to the original creditor and or the account number. Okay, we are on the quiz section. I want to make sure that these things stay in your head. We are doing some true or false. So true or false. It is a violation to willfully and recklessly report inaccurate date last active after being notified of the reporting error and failing to investigate or correct the error. The correct answer, of course, it is True, it is most definitely a violation, okay? Question number two, true or false? Questioning the existence of an account is hard for the credit bureaus to prove and should be used first. The correct answer, please tell me you know the correct answer. The correct answer is false. It is not hard. It is super easy for them, and that is definitely not what you should be doing, and most definitely not first, okay? Question number three, true or false? It is not a violation to fail to report the account as disputed to the credit bureaus. The wrong answer is true, okay? It is a violation to fail to report the account as disputed to the credit bureaus pursuant to Section 623. All accounts should be reported as disputed within 30 days of the date that they received your first dispute. True or false? We have 19 account elements to check out for inaccuracies before we ever even talk about inconsistencies between the bureaus. The correct answer is true. We most definitely have 19 account elements to check out. That's where we were going over, you know, is the status correct, the date last active, the past due amount. All right. Question number five, true or false? It's best to use factual disputes because it is targeted, strategic, and tactical. There's no one size fits all. The wrong answer to this is false. Why is it false? Because it is best to use factual disputes because it's targeted, strategic, and tactical, okay? So don't fall into this whole perpetual cycle just because you're using the wrong methods, okay? Now, here are some resources for you, all right? You can continue to do this yourself, and I give you a ton of resources. Down in the description, you can access a bunch of videos that go with this video to give you more of a breakdown and understanding, or you can go check out the free subscriber hub at vault.my740.com, and there's downloads, apps, a bunch of stuff, right? And I mean, alternately, you can actually have me do it for you if I can help, if it would be a good fit. And to find out if it would be a good fit, just go to my740.com, schedule a call, and I will see if I can help, all right? Now, lastly, I have a new podcast coming out. I will post the link when it is available because I am switching platforms. So, I mean, the bottom line here is that everything you need is just one click away, whether that means doing it yourself or having me do it for you. So thanks for watching. Make sure to like, comment, and subscribe. I will see you tomorrow for another daily video. And if you like this video, please smash that like. And if you are subscribed but haven't, smashed the bell for notifications yet, make sure you do so, because otherwise you won't be notified of videos just like this. So that was 41 challenges and violations, 19 dispute reasons or dispute elements that you can check out, 11 creditor violations, and 11 credit bureau violations. All right. So I hope you have a wonderful day. Make sure to go down into the description, click on those links so that you can use this to capitalize and get those results. Have a great one. Today we are going over 5 different ways to write a dispute reason for the same account type. Now, you might have multiple collections or multiple charge-offs or multiple accounts that have late payments, and you don't want to use the same thing every single time. Date last active on this one, date last active on this one, date last active on this one, date last active on this one. But if you want to stay at the top of the hierarchy in the pyramid, you kind of want to use this information. So I'm going to show you exactly how to do this so that it does not come back as frivolous. All right. So going across left to right, at the top, we have charge-offs, and left to right on the bottom, we have collections. So let's check this out. Charge-off example one, and we're using the dispute element date last active. You've reported different dates under the date of last activity. Enter your dates there. Stop reporting due to FCRA non-compliance of inaccurate data being furnished on the consumer report. Charge off example two, using date last active. Inaccurate data is being furnished and this account needs to stop reporting for FCRA non-compliance. You see how it's the same language but not? There are different dates last active reported, and this is where you put your dates. How can there be different dates when this is what stipulates when the account naturally falls off? You can't report different months and different years. Okay, so we're saying the same thing, but we're not. So yes, you are still going to want to use the 5-part formula for a dispute reason, but I'm just trying to show you that you don't have to say the exact same thing every single time, even though you want to use the same dispute reason type. Charge-off example number three, date last active. I would like for you to remove this account because the dates are completely different when I look at the dates and the date of last activity. See how many times I use the date there? Now, this is where you're going to put the actual dates. I know that it's supposed to be the same date. Inaccurate data is being furnished and this account needs to stop reporting for FCRA noncompliance. Now, some of these are a little bit longer and that's okay, but the only reason that I'm showing it to you like this is just to give you an idea of how you can write your reasons differently. Were we on three? Nope, we were on four. Using the element date last paid. Date last paid shows multiple dates and this makes it look like I paid when I didn't and didn't when I paid. How is that possible? How can there be years between bureaus, meaning different years? Inaccurate data is being furnished, blah, blah, blah. In other words, delete the damn thing, right? All right, so charge off example number five using first date of delinquency. Account has the date of first delinquency reported inaccurately, and this means that the entire account must be removed for inaccuracy, okay? So there's different ways that you can dispute the same thing. These are all for charge-offs. Now let's take a look at collections, right? And this is using the dispute reason that the account is either unknown or unverified, and this is very straightforward. I don't know what this is. Please remove this unverified account unless you can furnish a signed contract. And here is example number two. Using the dispute reason that the account is either unknown or unverified, delete this account because you cannot furnish any documentation that would verify ownership. Remove this unverified account. Okay, so now we're talking about debt buyers. The other one would be used for utility, medical, so on and so forth. All right. So date last paid shows multiple dates and this makes it look like I paid when I didn't and didn't when I paid. Doesn't that sound familiar? That's because this is an example of using non-collection dispute reasons for collections. So it doesn't have to be specifically for a collection. It just needs to be something that's going to target the account and get the account removed. Okay. And here's another one for an account such as portfolio recovery. Delete this account because the collection is past due by default and therefore cannot report a past due. It's actually a violation. Here's another one for an account such as portfolio recovery. Delete this account for violation because it reports late payments in the payment history, even though it's a collection. All right. So don't fret, don't freak out, don't blow your head off when you have multiple of the same account. Charge off, charge off, charge off, charge off, charge off. Collection, 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 collection. All you have to do is find the thing that's going to give the biggest impact and the best possible chance of removal for that account, and then write your reasons so that they are just different. They're just different, okay? I just don't want for you to write, remove this account or delete this account because the date last active is inaccurate. Date, 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 date. Delete this account because the account, the date last active is inaccurate. Delete this account because the date last paid is inaccurate. Date, date, date. Delete this account because the date last paid is inaccurate. Date, date, date. You can't do that, okay? So what I want for you to do is go click on the link, check this out yourself, and start thinking about how you can change up the wording for your disputes when you have the same account type, all right? So if you have questions about this, very simply, post a comment, let me know, post a comment anyways, and let me know what you're struggling with, because that means that I can create content that is going to help you, all right? So for right now, I hope you have a wonderful day. I will see you for another daily video tomorrow, and make sure to like this video, comment as I mentioned, share it with someone who might need it more than you, and I will see you tomorrow. Have a great one. We are back with another client win video. I'm sharing this client with you who jumped 132 points with their credit score in just 60 days. Now, is that going to happen with everyone? Absolutely not. And if anyone tells you otherwise, they are 300% BSing you. Now, I'm never going to do that, but I do want to inspire you, give you hope, and make sure that you don't get frustrated and give up and let them win. You see, when this client signed up in February, they had no Equifax score, a 474 on Experian, and a 481 on TransUnion. However, two rounds later, now we have a 613 finally on Equifax, a 606 on Experian, and a 590 on TransUnion. Take a look at the actual reports. So these are the current scores, 590, 606, and 613. And here is the report originally. There you go, 481, 474, and absolutely no Equifax score. So if you are currently struggling, number one, post in the comments and let me know what you're struggling with so that I can either create a video or, you know, figure out how else I can help you. And check out the free resources at vault.my740.com Or if this is something where you want me to do it for you, very simply go to my740.com, schedule a call with me, and I will see if I can help. That is it for today. I will see you tomorrow for another daily video. And make sure to comment on this video, like it, subscribe if you haven't done so, and share it with a friend. I'll see you tomorrow. I'm going to show you a super simple systematic flow that you can use to take the information from your credit report and turn it into disputes that get results. And this is even if you've never done this before. So the first thing we want to do is figure out what it is that we need to dispute. So we are first going to do a credit report analysis. Now, pausing right there real quick, I have my clients use IdentityIQ. You can use whatever you want, and you can take this with a grain of salt or etch it in your Bible. It's completely up to you. But my recommendation is to use IdentityIQ, or you can even use Smart Credit. Now, I only use IdentityIQ for my clients, but it's very simply because it shows me the information I need that's going to be at the top of the hierarchy in the pyramid method, such as date last active, date last paid, date last reported, so on and so forth. And those are the things that are going to remove charge-offs, collections, foreclosures, repossessions, all those things that really, really, really drop your credit score, right? Now, if you want to get access to IdentityIQ, all three reports and scores, but you don't want to pay their full price, use my discounted link down in the description. So let's move forward. We're going to do our credit report analysis. And for this example, we have one medical collection that is unknown, another medical collection for $50, a K Jewelers charge-off for $100, credit acceptance repo for $16,000, and an apartment eviction under public records for $3,000, and a late payment on American Express. And the account was closed, zero balance. Now, what we need to do is figure out, number one, what's hurting me the most? Number two, what's kind of like mid? And number three, what is the least impactful to my credit score? And we do this very, very simply. So using this example, we have K Jewelers, the charge-off, the eviction, and the repo. Those are most hurtful to my credit score. The mid is just the late payment, and the least is going to be obviously those two medical collections. Now, you also need to have a goal for your credit score. So in this example, we have a 500 on Experian, 496 on TransUnion, and a 505 on Equifax. My goal is to increase at least 140 points. So I want to get to a 640 on all three bureaus, all right? So now we know what's hurting the most, mid and least. Now I want to put down my goals in writing. Okay, I want to remove this eviction, repo, and charge off in less than 9 months. And in less than 6 months, I want to get rid of the late payment. And in less than 4 months, I want to get rid of those collections. And then, as I mentioned, in the next 12 months, I want to raise my score at least 140 points. So now that we have our action plan, our analysis, and our goals, we need to figure out what inaccuracies we can use taken directly from those accounts on the credit report to put in our disputes. So what I did was I created our inaccuracies. The medical collection, that one's really simple. I already told you I don't know it, so it's unverifiable. The next one, I'm just gonna use the validation of debt method directly with the collector and with the bureaus. I'm first gonna tell them that it's unknown. Now, with K Jewelers, I'm noticing that there are three different dates last active, and in those dates, there's two different years. You know that's not possible. The apartment eviction, the balance is zero on TransUnion, and the other two have it as 3,000. For the repo, the high balance is lower than the balance. That is not possible because the high balance means it is the highest balance the account has ever had. That's actually a violation. Anywho, the late payment on American Express is reported differently in all three bureaus. Equifax reports it on time, and TransUnion is June 2020 and Experian shows May 2020. So now what I need to do is I need to take all this information and create my dispute in my letter planning. You see, what I do is I like to have everything in pieces, make sure that these pieces make sense, and then put them all together when I'm using a system like this. But it works. It works when you're breaking it down backwards, and it works when you're putting it together for your planner, okay? So our very first sentence is really, really simple. The opening of this is, please remove these inaccurate accounts from my credit report. Send me a new credit report reflecting these changes. So I have my opener. Now I took those accounts plus those dispute reasons and I put them together and place them under that paragraph. As you can see, it says K Jewelers account number 12345. Delete this account because three different dates last active report as date, date, and date. You see what I'm saying? The first thing that I showed you was that we have these multiple accounts to remove. And then after we did our action plan, I showed you the inaccuracies. So all I did was I took those inaccuracies for that account and I put it together. And that would be my creditor name, account number, and dispute reason. All right, so let's go to the next one. Credit acceptance, account number 12345. Delete this account because the high balance is lower than the balance. Super simple, right? Apartment eviction, D12345. Delete for inaccuracy because the balance is zero on TransUnion, and then Experian and Equifax show 3,000. Now, with American Express account number 12345, it says remove the late payment for inaccuracy because TU, TransUnion, reports June 2020 late, Experian reports May 2020 late, and Equifax reports accurately that I paid on time. Now, regardless of whether I was late or not, I'm using Equifax to basically say, as you can see, that I paid on time. Here's the proof, I paid on time. So you need to remove yours from my credit report. You see how that works? Now, medical collection 12345, this account is unknown and needs to be deleted from my credit report. Medical collection 12345B, I don't know what this is. Delete this unverifiable account. Thank you, your name. So the very next step to this would be pretty obvious. It would be taking it from this page, putting it onto some sort of document processor such as Word or Notepad, and then sending it out into the mail. So let's recap real quick. We first pull our credit report and figure out what needs to be disputed. Then we look at what is hurting us the most. Then we create our goals and look at our credit scores. Then we find our inaccuracies. And then we put it all together. Now, I'm going to be doing a virtual workshop where I go way more into depth how you can take your accounts and figure out exactly what you need to do by breaking this all down and then putting it together. You see, none of this needs to be difficult. And sometimes it may seem too difficult to even want to take on, right? But I'm going to show you exactly how you can use this systematic flow to make very, very effective disputes that get results. So for right now, that is it in this video. I will see you later or tomorrow for another daily video. And if you need help, not for the workshop because I haven't come out with that yet, but if you need help, you want to see if I can take over your file and do the credit sweep for you, very simply, go down into the description, click on the link, and go to my740.com and schedule a call with me, and I will see if I can help. Now, if you want to continue on with the do-it-yourself method, there's nothing wrong with that. I have a ton of free resources in addition to the 500 videos right here on YouTube. Go and check out the Vault, okay? The subscriber hub on the Vault at vault.my740.com is going to give you a ton of free stuff, okay? So go check that out, but otherwise, I will see you later. Post a comment on this video letting me know what you are currently struggling with. Like this video, share it with someone who might need it, and I will see you later. Subscribe if you haven't done so yet. All right, bye. Today, we are going over how to write a dispute letter that gets results. And we're doing this by going over the checklist. So you see, I've broken down all of my letters that have resulted in extreme deletions and credit score increases, and each of them meet the requirements in this checklist. We're going to go over all six steps, and I'll show you exactly what to include in your dispute letters to get the maximum results in the least amount of time. Now, make sure you stay to the end to find out one of my top three tactics for getting results. So here is our example letter, and most of this is taken from, just like I mentioned, my top letters that have resulted in extreme results. And as you can see, there are highlighted sections, and we're going to match these to the actual checklist. So take a look at the checklist. We have opener, reason, follow-up, identification, method, and frequency. And if you take a look at the actual letter, you're going to see that I've highlighted three different sentences. So just real quick, we have Bobby McBobness, we have his information, including date of birth and social, as well as the bureau. Now, additionally, you can throw in the date on there, but that's pretty straightforward, so I did not include that. So look at the three sentences that I've highlighted. So take a look at opener. The opener says it is required to have a request for investigation, reason for investigation, request for a new credit report, and any additional information. So let's go find this on the actual letter. As you can see, sentence number one is highlighted. It says, I don't believe that there's been an actual investigation on these accounts and you failed to furnish any documentation that proves that they're reported correctly. Because of this, I need for you to perform an independent investigation and blah, 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 blah. Jump to that last sentence in the first paragraph. I'd like a new report reflecting these changes requested below. And then my second paragraph is additional information. So as you can see, I've requested my investigation. I've given a reason for the investigation because I don't believe that they even did an investigation and I'd like an independent one. I've asked for my new report and I provided additional information that I'm getting really frustrated because they keep telling me that I'm wrong when I'm sending the information taken directly from the credit report. You see how simple that is? So when you know exactly what to write, it makes it so much easier to target your results, all right? So let's go to the next step. So on the bottom part of the letter, we have the actual accounts that we are disputing. Take a look at the reason checklist. It says we need the action, justifier, reason, and outcome, right? So just as a side note there, I do have a video that's going to be linked at the very end of this video, and it's for the dispute letter magic, where we're going to go into the science behind each part of this formula, all right? And it actually resulted in over 20,000 deletions in 2020. So if you want to check that out, make sure you wait to the end of the video and click on it on the end screen. So let's go back to this. As you can see, just as the top part of the letter, we have things that are highlighted. So we need the action, justifier, reason, and outcome, right? So for capital one, we're saying delete for inaccuracy because the balance is reported as $22, $25, and $29. I mean, obviously those are three totally different numbers, right? And these are actual reasons taken directly from letters that I've sent out. These are not made up, okay? So delete for capital one is going to be our action. Because it's a justifier, the reason is balance is reported as 22, 25, and 29. Now, outcome is optional. Outcome, I normally only use outcome for late payments. And you're going to see that on the Discover account. So now we have an unknown collection and I'm seeing delete, which is the action for false reporting because the justifier, no furnisher name or address reports, and that is the reason. And you failed to correct this from my first dispute. That's everything that you need to write. There's no additional information that's required, okay? Discover, remove, that's the action, the late payment on June 2020 because justifier. It's reported as 30 days late, but Equifax and TransUnion both report that I paid on time. That's the reason. Update the status to reflect that I paid on time. That is the outcome. That's what I want them to do. I told them why I'm disputing it, what I want them to do, which is remove it, and what the outcome should be, that I want them to correct something, okay? Now, let's look at our last one, XYZ apartment collection 12345. Stop reporting, that's the action, this account because, that's a justifier, I disputed this on the date of my first dispute and the notice of dispute was not entered, that's my reason, within the 30-day time period. Delete for violation of section 623. Now, I did tell you that I was going to let you know one of my top three tactics for removing negative items, and that's a little bit of a hint right there, all right? So let's go to the next step. Now you see that we have met all the requirements for the reasons, the requirements for the opener, and let's check out the other things that you need to know about to get your results. Let's jump over to identification. With every single letter, every single time they go out the door, you should be sending a copy of your identification, license or military or passport, social security card or W-2 or something that has your full number listed on it, 12345678, right? And proof of address and know your identification, meaning your license, your state ID, your passport, whatever, that's not proof of address. a birth certificate cannot be used, right? You're talking about utility bill or cell phone bill or pay stub or bank statement, whatever. Those are proof of address every single time. Okay, I see this in the comments all the time. Do I have to send this out every single time? Yes, you do, my friend. Yes, you do. Okay, now follow up. Every single time that you send out your next dispute, always make sure that you are checking for violations before you send out your letter, okay? Violations not in your letter, but you can use these when you're crafting your action plan because every single letter has its own action plan, right? Now, look at the response analysis. What is Experian or what is Equifax or what is TransUnion sending to you? If they're sending anything, are they saying that they're no longer going to reinvestigate? Are they saying that it's just verified? Are they saying that it's certified as accurate? What are they saying? Because you can use it in your letters when you're crafting your opener, right? Or even your dispute reason. Now, report comparison. What that means is that you need to look at the original report versus your current new report before you write your disputes. The reason, and this is pretty straightforward, but the reason is, number one, you have to make sure that that account is still on the credit report, that it was not deleted. Number two, you're looking for violations. Like I said, it's the notice of dispute on there. Did they certify or verify it as accurate, but did not update the date last reported? Did they change or re-age the date of last activity? So on and so forth. You have to have this new information, right? And then that takes me to the next part. New information. What new information is on your credit report that can be used in your dispute letter? Because that is how you craft factual-based disputes, because you're taking the facts directly from your credit report. Now, method. This needs to go out regular mail or certified, but doesn't have to be certified. I mean, unless you want to spend $21 or more per round, completely up to you. It's not going to make it happen any quicker. I mean, you're paying the post office. You're not paying the bureaus to have a faster, you know, investigation, okay? It needs to be a custom letter. You need to be using factual reasons, and it needs to be consumer authentic if you are a business. Now, frequency. Normally, it's 30 days, right? But if you send something in the middle of the month, they can add 15 days for additional info. Don't send mid-month disputes for the same account, all right? 15 days for, obviously, what we're currently going through. Now, I know that this recently ended, but they are still taking that additional time. And they can take that additional time, and they're going to use it as an excuse for the second thing that we went over, all right? So always be aware of the timing. Okay. And then add 4 days for that mail sending. All right. And that's really useful if you are not sending out certified mail. Just count 4 days. They should have received the letter. Now you can start your counting. Now you know when to pull your next report. Now you know when to send your next round of disputes. All right. So do you have any questions about this? If you don't understand something, you don't understand how to do factual-based disputes, you don't understand what this checklist is for, you don't understand the 5-part, you know, formula, whatever it is, post it in the comments and I will answer it. I will help you with whatever it is, okay? Now, as promised, this is one of my top 3 tactics or my secrets, and it's using the notice of dispute. So one of the fastest ways to get a deletion is to catch the credit bureaus and even collectors in a violation for failure to enter the required notice of dispute. So you see, if it's not reported on the account, like in the comment section within 30 days of receiving the first dispute, it's a violation. I mean, this is actually the magic behind the validation of debt method. Now, I have removed countless accounts just using this one violation. It is that important, okay? So always remember that you need to know your violations. And once you know your violations, once you know how an account should be reported, how it should not be reported, then you're putting yourself in the best possible place to get the maximum results in the least amount of time, all right? Now, if you want to learn more, if you want to reach out, then here are 2 very, very simple links. My740.com will take you to my booking page if you want to see if I can take over your file and do the credit sweep for you. Now, the second link, vault.my740.com, is actually where you can go to get access to the free subscriber hub and a bunch of other awesome resources, okay? So, anywho, now we are at the end of the video, and like I said, this is actually going to be where you can click on the dispute letter magic video, where we go into the science behind the 5-part formula that generated over 20,000 deletions last year. And make sure to hit that like and subscribe if you haven't done so, and I will see you next time. In today's video, we are going to go over what to do when the bureaus won't reinvestigate. And this is part two. You see, we started a brand new FAQ series for credit sweeps. But instead of moving on to the next question, I'm going to give you concrete proof to show you exactly how to deal with this stall tactic. So you're going to see concrete evidence directly from Experian that proves they only take factual disputes seriously. And I'm going to show you exactly how to handle a refusal to investigate any future disputes. Now, these are three of the things, and only three, that we are going to answer. Disputing a blank will change your dispute timing from 30 days to 45. A violation of Section 611 happens when the bureaus refuse to investigate a blank. And the credit bureaus must reinvestigate when you tell them blank as required by law. Are you ready? Here we have a direct response from Experian where they're stating, we're not going to reinvestigate these accounts. And I actually had to go way back to 2015 to find this in my vault. So let's take a look and break this down. The first section is very, very clear. They reject you simply by stating that the credit granter has verified the accuracy of the account disputed. This is basically telling you that you've reached the end of the road and to go away. Now, Section 611 says they can reject your dispute if you submitted the same dispute. Like, for example, if you said it's unknown or unverified and then sent another dispute saying the same thing, they can reject this for that reason. However, my records show that back in 2015, each dispute letter for this client was factual and taken directly from his credit report, therein making the statement null and void. Now, what you should take away from this is that when you send a new and relevant dispute, they cannot reject based on Section 611 and must actually reinvestigate. Now, here's the proof that using factual disputes is the only way to beat this tactic. It says, if you have additional relevant information that was not presented when you previously disputed the information. In other words, when you send a new dispute reason that has never been used before, they will reinvestigate the disputed info. And here's the big kicker. When you send in templates, you're not specifying the reason the account is inaccurate. You're basically saying that something is unverified and they have to remove it. However, as you can see here, it says that when you tell them specifically why you believe this account or information is inaccurate, they process your dispute as required by law. Now, as I said, I've been searching for this info for years, and you know, I basically totally forgot where I found it, and here it is. The reason you don't want to dispute annual free credit report is because it turns your 30-day investigation into a 45-day investigation. So if you want faster results, make sure to stay away from free annual reports. And here's why so many companies con consumers into signing up. This says that if the bureaus don't receive a response from the furnisher or vendor within the required period, we update the item as you have requested or delete the information. What they're not saying is that the bureaus normally respond, and when they don't, it says they did in their system. And when the creditor or vendor catches up on their paperwork, they can reinsert the accounts even though they were previously deleted. Now, the second to last thing here is what I love about using factual disputes. It says that in some instances, upon reviewing your credit file on any relevant information you have submitted to us, we are able to determine whether the disputed information should be changed or deleted without having to contact the furnisher or the vendor. Imagine sending in a dispute that says this account is unknown, or this account is not mine, or the account is unverified. They will absolutely have to send it over to the furnisher to investigate. However, if you sent in a dispute that proves the balance is reported differently on all three bureaus, or that the required dispute is not entered within the required time frame, or something else that is factual and can be proven in a similar fashion, they can remove the account without contacting them. Which would you rather use? Now, here we're on the last statement that they want to drive home, even though they already said it. Unless you send us additional relevant information to support your claim, we will not reinvestigate this information again. So here's the question. What do we do when we receive one of these responses from the credit bureaus, and how can we try to prevent? See, now we're going to answer that question right now. We've already proven that disputing a free annual credit report will change your dispute timing from 30 days to 45 days, and a violation of Section 611 happens when the bureaus refuse to investigate a duplicate dispute or a same dispute, and the credit bureaus must reinvestigate when you tell them specifically why you believe the information is inaccurate as required by law. So here's the solution, and this is the proactive solution. Now, with your credit report, I recommend one place to consistently pull your report, and I actually use IdentityIQ for my clients, and you can find a discounted link in the description. Don't give the bureaus an additional 15 days just because you want a free annual report. Now, your letter should only state why you're writing it, what you want them to do, what you're disputing, and why you're disputing it. That's it. As far as your reason, the dispute reason should specifically state which element is inaccurate, what you want them to do about it, why it's inaccurate, and what the outcome should be. And that's optional, more for late payments. Now, if this does happen to you, you obviously have to handle this reactively. Now, with Section 611, you can state that they are in violation for refusing to reinvestigate a new factual dispute. And this is the beauty of factual-based dispute systems, because your next dispute is always the next best reason taken directly from the credit report. So that's additional relevant information not having previously been disputed. Excuse me. Now, my recommendation is to use these arguments in your initial paragraph instead of the actual dispute reason, because this is going to save you from spinning in circles with the bureaus. So if you want to see this in action, your paragraph one of your letter can basically say, I'm submitting new and relative information and requesting a reinvestigation of the following accounts per Section 611. And now your dispute reasons, not on your first one, but your second dispute could be, delete this account because I disputed it on date and you did not enter the required notice of dispute by date plus 30, which is a violation of Section 623. Or delete this account because Experian shows a balance of zero, Equifax 2008, and TransUnion 522. As you can see, both of these are specific and factual. So that is how you would handle it reactively. Now, how can you use this to increase your results? I want for you to click on the link in the description to get to this page, the entire presentation actually, and I want you to write down how you can use this solution to optimize your dispute strategy proactively, and how you can increase your chances of deletions or corrections using this solution reactively. Okay. Now, what we went over today was how to handle this when it's verified as accurate, and how to deal with the no reinvestigation, and two different solutions using proactive and reactive approaches. Now, you can check out the next video, which is the 6-part dispute letter checklist, if you haven't done so already. And it basically is going to help you optimize your results using this checklist. That link is also in the description, and I'm probably going to tag this on the end screen. Now that we are at the end and we've done our recap, I want to let you know that you can actually go to vault.my740.com and access a ton of awesome free content in the member vault on the subscribers hub. This will help you learn how to do factual-based disputes, or if this is just not something that you want to do yourself, that's totally cool. You can go to my740.com and schedule a call with me, and I will see if I can help. So that is it for today. Make sure to click on one of the other videos, including the 6-part dispute letter checklist that's going to help you increase. In today's video, we are going over 41 challenges and violations, and it breaks down to 19 things you can dispute on an account, 11 credit bureau violations, and 11 creditor violations. We're starting with the problem, then I'm going to give you the dispute reasons, the bureau violations, creditor violations, and lastly, a quiz, because I want to make sure that you understand this so that you can capitalize and get your results. So I'm going to show you what can easily be disputed on your credit report, how to spot the violations, and like I said, we are going to also have a quiz. All right, so here is the problem. It has always been my professional and tested opinion that the biggest problem is understanding the difference between methods that put a temporary band-aid on and one that gets permanent fixes, right? You see, we don't want to use vague general disputes because, yeah, they can get results, but they're normally added back to the credit report quickly. And we don't want that. We do not want that. Do you really want to be checking your credit report every 5 days? And then questioning the existence of an account might actually be very easy for the bureaus or the furnisher to prove. So you don't want to make their job easier for them. And using the same dispute reason each time, like unverified, can get results, but you're more than likely to get a rejection for further investigation. And you can check out the description for the videos on this where I break down why this happens and how to get around this, okay? You want to beat the system. We're not trying to fool it. We're trying to beat it and get results. And then a one-size-fits-all type of deal for disputes, it normally gets a response that says verified is accurate with no actual investigation, all right? So here's the solution, and it's the only solution. And I am very adamant about this. Factual-based disputes. Challenging other sections of the reporting can prove to be more difficult because, again, we're not making their job easy for the bureaus and furnishers than dealing with the general statements they normally get. What is so special about your disputes? If you can't really answer that, then you're not disputing the right way, okay? This is what I've been doing for each of my clients for 6.5 years and what resulted in over 20,000 deletions in 2020 alone, okay? So now when you're constructing your disputes, my recommendation is keep it real. You can take this with a grain of salt or you can etch it in your Bible, it's up to you. But my recommendation is always to keep your disputes factual. And here's the deal. Factual doesn't mean that it's valid, true, verified, yours, or anything similar. Factual means that you're not trying to flam the bureaus with general disputes, lies, or anything else. Our job is to get legal, permanent results, and the highest scores possible. Well, this is how I do it. My letters include facts, and the info is taken directly from the client's credit report. And when I construct their disputes, I follow very specific formulas. And again, you could find those videos linked in the description. So let's take a look at 19 things that you can check, and these are dispute elements per each account, okay? And some of these may look very, very familiar. So the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to check for blatant inaccuracies. And that doesn't always mean that you have three different balances or, you know, three different past dues or just dates that don't make sense. It's little things that you know to be inaccurate before you ever compare bureaus, okay? So just for an example, is the account number correct? The date the account was established? The high balance? The credit limit? The terms? The frequency of payments? Status? Balance? Past due balance? Should there be a past due balance at all? What about the date last payment? What about the payment amount? First delinquency? Is it reflecting as a charge-off correctly or incorrectly? What about the charge-off amount, the date close, type of account, responsibility section, like where it says it's authorized user, individual? What about the additional information section? Was the date last, was the notice of dispute entered? Does it say that it was disputed by consumer? Anything that is very similar to that, okay? If not, then you need to use these and capitalize to get your results. Okay, so here are your next steps. So this is what you do with this information. So this is actually where so many consumers get stuck. Let's say that you found something inaccurate on your account. Now what? I'd actually recommend checking out the videos and resources linked in the description to learn more on how to construct your disputes, the 5-part formula generated over 20,000 plus deletions in 2020, how to write your letters to get maximum results, and how to virtually remove any negative item from your credit report. So let's get to the violations. We are going over the credit bureau violations, and there are 11 of them. All right, willfully and recklessly reporting false info after being notified of the reporting error and failing to investigate or correct the error. And this does include mixed files, inaccurate data status or last activity, inaccurate balance, inaccurate remarks, reinserting or re-reporting a previously deleted item without notifying you within writing within 5 business days of the reinsertion, failure to respond to a dispute within 30 days or 45 days for free annual report, and just a side note here, they can add 15 days in some cases where the creditor or the consumer has provided additional info applicable to the dispute. reporting a bankruptcy longer than 10 years from the date of adjudication, reporting a paid tax lien longer than 7 years, and just so you know, if it's unpaid, it can be 10, failing to update or report the status and or balance of the account that was included in bankruptcy as discharged with the zero balance, failing to provide, if requested after verification, the method of verification, including the real name, address and phone number of the furnisher within 15 days of your request, reporting a collection or charge-off longer than 7 years from the date of status or last activity, and just so you know, there are exceptions of credit transactions involving more than $150,000, the underwriting of life insurance involving over $150,000, or employment with an annual salary reasonably expected to exceed $75,000 a year. All right, we have a couple of more. Failing to notate that an item on your credit report is under dispute, in other words, notice of dispute, and we just talked about that. And yes, I see that typo right there. Reporting a record of arrest or conviction longer than 7 years, and failure to provide all relevant info to the furnisher when reasonable means to do so are available. Now, let's check out creditor violations, and some of these may look very, very, very familiar, all right? Ignoring an investigation request. And here we go again, willfully and recklessly reporting false info to the credit bureaus after being notified of the reporting error and failing to investigate or correct the error. And again, this includes mixed files, inaccurate data status or last activity, inaccurate balance, and inaccurate remarks. Reporting a charge-off account without reference to the date of status or last activity, and failure to report an account disputed by the consumer as disputed to the credit bureaus. And we got some more here, transferring or selling an account to another company without reporting the transfer and or zero balance. I see this one all the time. Failing to update the status and or balance of an account that was included in bankruptcy as discharged with a zero balance. Falsely reporting the ownership of an account to a non-liable consumer like the spouse, family member, etc. And withholding account data with intent to negatively affect a consumer's credit score. Okay, like the credit limit. I see this all the time with Capital One and Barclays. And guess what? Capital One admitted in testimony during a lawsuit that they do this purposely. Okay, so this is where you're going to see it say high balance is credit limit, or credit limit is high balance, or anything to that effect. The credit limit should be the credit limit. If the credit limit is $2,500, but the high balance was only $200, that's much different than it saying that the credit limit is the high balance, because the high balance, if it was only $200, that's way less than $2,500. So that means that they're screwing with the utilization. That's why it's so important to understand these things, okay? Failing to delete a hard inquiry that had no permissible purpose, and you can go check out my free inquiry removal webinar that was posted within the last 60 days right here on YouTube. And just so you know, permissible purpose does not mean that they just, you know, got shotgunned your application for a dealership, you know, for a vehicle, and that you didn't, you know, get a firm offer, okay? So it's either a firm offer of credit, employment, insurance, court order, child support, things like that. If it does not fall into any of those categories, then it does not belong on your credit report, okay? Reporting a new duplicate account after receiving notice of dispute on the old account. Reporting an account with false reference or without reference to the original creditor and or the account number. Okay, we are on the quiz section. I want to make sure that these things stay in your head. We are doing some true or false. So true or false. It is a violation to willfully and recklessly report inaccurate, date last active after being notified of the reporting error and failing to investigate or correct the error. The correct answer, of course, it is true. It is most definitely a violation, okay? Question number two, true or false? Questioning the existence of an account is hard for the credit bureaus to prove and should be used first. The correct answer, please tell me you know the correct answer. The correct answer is false. It is not hard. It is super easy for them, and that is definitely not what you should be doing, and most definitely not first, okay? Question number three, true or false? It is not a violation to fail to report the account as disputed to the credit bureaus. The wrong answer is true. Okay, it is a violation to fail to report the account as disputed to the credit bureaus pursuant to Section 623. All accounts should be reported as disputed within 30 days of the date that they received your first dispute. True or false? We have 19 account elements to check out for inaccuracies before we ever even talk about inconsistencies between the bureaus. The correct answer is true. We most definitely have 19 account elements to check out. That's where we were going over, you know, is the status correct, the date last active, the past due amount. All right. Question number 5, true or false? It's best to use factual disputes because it is targeted, strategic, and tactical. There's no one size fits all. The wrong answer to this is false. Why is it false? Because it is best to use factual disputes because it's targeted, strategic, and tactical, okay? So don't fall into this whole perpetual cycle just because you're using the wrong methods, okay? Now, here are some resources for you, all right? You can continue to do this yourself, and I give you a ton of resources. Down in the description, you can access a bunch of videos that go with this video to give you more of a breakdown and understanding, or you can go check out the free subscriber hub at vault.my740.com, and there's downloads, apps, a bunch of stuff, right? And I mean, alternately, you can actually have me do it for you if I can help, if it would be a good fit. And to find out if it would be a good fit, just go to my740.com, schedule a call, and I will see if I can help, all right? Now, lastly, I have a new podcast coming out. I will post the link when it is available because I am switching platforms. So, I mean, the bottom line here is that everything you need is just one click away, whether that means doing it yourself or having me do it for you. So thanks for watching. Make sure to like, comment, and subscribe. I will see you tomorrow for another daily video. And if you like this video, please smash that like. And if you are subscribed but haven't, smashed the bell for notifications yet, make sure you do so, because otherwise you won't be notified of videos just like this. So that was 41 challenges and violations, 19 dispute reasons or dispute elements that you can check out, 11 creditor violations, and 11 credit bureau violations, all right? So I hope you have a wonderful day. Make sure to go down into the description, click on those links so that you can use this to capitalize and get those results. Have a great one. Today we are going over 5 different ways to write a dispute reason for the same account type. Now, you might have multiple collections or multiple charge-offs or multiple accounts that have late payments, and you don't want to use the same thing every single time. Date last active on this one, date last active on this one, date last active on this one, date last active on this one. But if you want to stay at the top of the hierarchy in the pyramid, you kind of want to use this information. So I'm going to show you exactly how to do this so that it does not come back as frivolous. All right. So going across left to right, at the top, we have charge-offs, and left to right on the bottom, we have collections. So let's check this out. Charge-off example 1, and we're using the dispute element date last active. You've reported different dates under the date of last activity. Enter your dates there. Stop reporting due to FCRA non-compliance of inaccurate data being furnished on the consumer report. Charge-off example 2, using date last active. Inaccurate data is being furnished, and this account needs to stop reporting for FCRA non-compliance. You see how it's the same language, but not? There are different dates last active reported, and this is where you put your dates. How can there be different dates when this is what stipulates when the account naturally falls off? You can't report different months and different years. Okay, so we're saying the same thing, but we're not. So yes, you are still going to want to use the 5-part formula for a dispute reason, but I'm just trying to show you that you don't have to say the exact same thing every single time, even though you want to use the same dispute reason type. Charge-off example number 3, date last active. I would like for you to remove this account because the dates are completely different when I look at the dates and the date of last activity. See how many times I use the date there? Now, this is where you're going to put the actual dates. I know that it's supposed to be the same date. Inaccurate data is being furnished and this account needs to stop reporting for FCRA non-compliance. Now, some of these are a little bit longer and that's okay, but the only reason that I'm showing it to you like this is just to give you an idea of how you can write your reasons differently. Were we on 3? Nope, we were on 4. Using the element date last paid. Date last paid shows multiple dates and this makes it look like I paid when I didn't and didn't when I paid. How is that possible? How can there be years between bureaus, meaning different years? Inaccurate data is being furnished, blah, blah, blah. In other words, delete the damn thing, right? All right, so charge off example number 5, using first date of delinquency. Account has the date of first delinquency reported inaccurately, and this means that the entire account must be removed for inaccuracy, okay? So there's different ways that you can dispute the same thing. These are all for charge offs. Now let's take a look at collections, right? And this is using the dispute reason that the account is either unknown or unverified, and this is very straightforward. I don't know what this is. Please remove this unverified account unless you can furnish a signed contract. And here is example number 2. Using the dispute reason that the account is either unknown or unverified, delete this account because you cannot furnish any documentation that would verify ownership. Remove this unverified account. Okay, so now we're talking about debt buyers. The other one would be used for utility, medical, so on and so forth, all right? So date last paid shows multiple dates, and this makes it look like I paid when I didn't and didn't when I paid. Doesn't that sound familiar? That's because this is an example of using non-collection dispute reasons for collections. So it doesn't have to be specifically for a collection. It just needs to be something that's going to target the account and get the account removed, okay? And here's another one for an account such as portfolio recovery. Delete this account because the collection is past due by default and therefore cannot report a past due. It's actually a violation. Here's another one for an account such as portfolio recovery. Delete this account for violation because it reports late payments in the payment history, even though it's a collection. All right. So don't fret, don't freak out, don't blow your head off when you have multiple of the same account. Charge off, charge off, charge off, charge off, charge off, collection, 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 collection. All you have to do is find the thing that's going to give the biggest impact and the best possible chance of removal for that account, and then write your reasons so that they are just different. They're just different, okay? I just don't want for you to write, remove this account or delete this account because the date last active is inaccurate. Date, 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 date. Delete this account because the account, the date last active is inaccurate. Delete, 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 blah, blah. Delete this account because the date last paid is inaccurate. Date, date, date. Delete this account because the date last paid is inaccurate. Date, date, date. You can't do that, okay? So what I want for you to do is go click on the link, check this out yourself, and start thinking about how you can change up the wording for your disputes when you have the same account type, all right? So if you have questions about this, very simply, post a comment, let me know, post a comment anyways, and let me know what you're struggling with, because that means that I can create content that is going to help you, all right? So for right now, I hope you have a wonderful day. I will see you for another daily video tomorrow, and make sure to like this video, comment as I mentioned, share it with someone who might need it more than you, and I will see you tomorrow. Have a great one. Hey, we are back with another client win video. I'm sharing this client with you who jumped 132 points with their credit score in just 60 days. Now, is that going to happen with everyone? Absolutely not. And if anyone tells you otherwise, they are 300% BSing you. Now, I'm never going to do that, but I do want to inspire you, give you hope, and make sure that you don't get frustrated and give up and let them win. You see, when this client signed up in February, they had no Equifax score, a 474 on Experian, and a 481 on TransUnion. However, 2 rounds later, now we have a 613 finally on Equifax, a 606 on Experian, and a 590 on TransUnion. Take a look at the actual reports. So these are the current scores, 590, 606, and 613. And here is the report originally. There you go, 481, 474, and absolutely no Equifax score. So if you are currently struggling, number one, post in the comments and let me know what you're struggling with so that I can either create a video or, you know, figure out how else I can help you. And check out the free resources at vault.my740.com. Or if this is something where you want me to do it for you, very simply go to my740.com, schedule a call with me, and I will see if I can help. That is it for today. I will see you tomorrow for another daily video. And make sure to comment on this video, like it, subscribe if you haven't done so, and share it with a friend. I'll see you tomorrow. Today, I'm going to show you a super simple systematic flow that you can use to take the information from your credit report and turn it into disputes that get results. And this is even if you've never done this before. So the first thing we want to do is figure out what it is that we need to dispute. So we are first going to do a credit report analysis. Now, pausing right there real quick, I have my clients use Identity IQ. You can use whatever you want, and you can take this with a grain of salt or etch it in your Bible. It's completely up to you. But my recommendation is to use Identity IQ, or you can even use Smart Credit. Now, I only use Identity IQ for my clients, but it's very simply because it shows me the information I need that's going to be at the top of the hierarchy in the pyramid method, such as date last active, date last paid, date last reported, so on and so forth. And those are the things that are going to remove charge-offs, collections, foreclosures, repossessions, all those things that really, really, really drop your credit score, right? Now, if you want to get access to Identity IQ, all three reports and scores, but you don't want to pay their full price, use my discounted link down in the description. So let's move forward. We're going to do our credit report analysis. And for this example, we have one medical collection that is unknown, another medical collection for $50, a K Jewelers charge-off for $100, credit acceptance repo for $16,000, and an apartment eviction under public records for $3,000, and a late payment on American Express. And the account was closed, zero balance. Now, what we need to do is figure out, number one, what's hurting me the most? Number two, what's kind of like mid? And number three, what is the least impactful to my credit score? And we do this very, very simply. So using this example, we have K Jewelers, the charge-off, the eviction, and the repo. Those are most hurtful to my credit score. The mid is just the late payment, and the least is going to be obviously those two medical collections. Now, you also need to have a goal for your credit score. So in this example, we have a 500 on Experian, 496 on TransUnion, and a 505 on Equifax. My goal is to increase at least 140 points. So I want to get to a 640 on all three bureaus. All right. So now we know what's hurting the most, mid and least. Now I want to put down my goals in writing. Okay, I want to remove this eviction, repo, and charge-off in less than 9 months. And in less than 6 months, I want to get rid of the late payment. And in less than 4 months, I want to get rid of those collections. And then, as I mentioned, in the next 12 months, I want to raise my score at least 140 points. So now that we have our action plan, our analysis, and our goals, we need to figure out what inaccuracies we can use taken directly from those accounts on the credit report to put in our disputes. So what I did was I created our inaccuracies. The medical collection, that one's really simple. I already told you I don't know it, so it's unverifiable. The next one, I'm just gonna use the validation of debt method directly with the collector and with the bureaus. I'm first gonna tell them that it's unknown. Now, with K Jewelers, I'm noticing that there are three different dates last active, and in those dates, there's two different years. You know that's not possible. The apartment eviction, the balance is zero on TransUnion, and the other two have it as $3,000. For the repo, the high balance is lower than the balance. That is not possible because the high balance means it is the highest balance the account has ever had. That's actually a violation. Anywho, the late payment on American Express is reported differently in all three bureaus. Equifax reports it on time, and TransUnion is June 2020 and Experian shows May 2020. So now what I need to do is I need to take all this information and create my dispute in my letter planning. You see, what I do is I like to have everything in pieces, make sure that these pieces make sense, and then put them all together when I'm using a system like this. But it works. It works when you're breaking it down backwards, and it works when you're putting it together for your planner, okay? So our very first sentence is really, really simple. The opening of this is, please remove these inaccurate accounts from my credit report. Send me a new credit report reflecting these changes. So I have my opener. Now I took those accounts plus those dispute reasons, and I put them together and placed them under that paragraph. As you can see, it says K Jewelers account number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Delete this account because three different dates last active report as date, date, and date. You see what I'm saying? The first thing that I showed you was that we have these multiple accounts to remove. And then after we did our action plan, I showed you the inaccuracies. So all I did was I took those inaccuracies for that account and I put it together. And that would be my creditor name, account number, and dispute reason. All right, so let's go to the next one. Credit acceptance, account number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Delete this account because the high balance is lower than the balance. Super simple, right? Apartment eviction, D12345. Delete foreign accuracy because the balance is zero on TransUnion, and then Experian and Equifax show 3,000. Now, with American Express account number 12345, it says remove the late payment for inaccuracy because TU, TransUnion, reports June 2020 late, Experian reports May 2020 late, and Equifax reports accurately that I paid on time. Now, regardless of whether I was late or not, I'm using Equifax to basically say, as you can see, that I paid on time. Here's the proof I paid on time. So you need to remove yours from my credit report. You see how that works? Now, medical collection 12345, this account is unknown and needs to be deleted from my credit report. Medical collection 12345B, I don't know what this is. Delete this unverifiable account. Thank you, your name. So the very next step to this would be pretty obvious. It would be taking it from this page, putting it onto some sort of document processor such as Word or Notepad, and then sending it out into the mail. So let's recap real quick. We first pull our credit report and figure out what needs to be disputed. Then we look at what is hurting us the most. Then we create our goals and look at our credit scores. Then we find our inaccuracies, and then we put it all together. Now, I'm going to be doing a virtual workshop where I go way more into depth how you can take your accounts and figure out exactly what you need to do by breaking this all down and then putting it together. You see, none of this needs to be difficult. And sometimes it may seem too difficult to even want to take on, right? But I'm going to show you exactly how you can use this systematic flow to make very, very effective disputes that get results. So for right now, that is it in this video. I will see you later or tomorrow for another daily video. And if you need help, not for the workshop because I haven't come out with that yet, but if you need help, you want to see if I can take over your file and do the credit sweep for you, very simply, go down into the description, click on the link, and go to my740.com and schedule a call with me, and I will see if I can help. Now, if you want to continue on with the do-it-yourself method, there's nothing wrong with that. I have a ton of free resources in addition to the 500 videos right here on YouTube. Go and check out the Vault, okay? The subscriber hub on the Vault at vault.my740.com is going to give you a ton of free stuff, okay? So go check that out, but otherwise, I will see you later. Post a comment on this video letting me know what you are currently struggling with. Like this video, share it with someone who might need it, and I will see you later. Subscribe if you haven't done so yet. All right, bye. Today, we are going over how to write a dispute letter that gets results, and we're doing this by going over the checklist. So you see, I've broken down all of my letters that have resulted in extreme deletions and credit score increases, and each of them meet the requirements in this checklist. We're going to go over all six steps, and I'll show you exactly what to include in your dispute letters to get the maximum results in the least amount of time. Now, make sure you stay to the end to find out one of my top three tactics for getting results. So here is our example letter, and most of this is taken from, just like I mentioned, my top letters that have resulted in extreme results. And as you can see, there are highlighted sections, and we're going to match these to the actual checklist. So take a look at the checklist. We have opener, reason, follow-up, identification, method, and frequency. And if you take a look at the actual letter, you're going to see that I've highlighted three different sentences. So just real quick, we have Bobby McBobness, we have his information, including date of birth and social, as well as the bureau. Now, additionally, you can throw in the date on there, but that's pretty straightforward, so I did not include that. So look at the three sentences that I've highlighted. So take a look at opener. The opener says it is required to have a request for investigation, reason for investigation, request for a new credit report, and any additional information. So let's go find this on the actual letter. As you can see, sentence number one is highlighted. It says, I don't believe that there's been an actual investigation on these accounts and you failed to furnish any documentation that proves that they're reported correctly. Because of this, I need for you to perform an independent investigation and blah, 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 blah. Jump to that last sentence in the first paragraph. I'd like a new report reflecting these changes requested below. And then my second paragraph is, additional information. So as you can see, I've requested my investigation. I've given a reason for the investigation because I don't believe that they even did an investigation and I'd like an independent one. I've asked for my new report and I provided additional information that I'm getting really frustrated because they keep telling me that I'm wrong when I'm sending the information taken directly from the credit report. You see how simple that is? So when you know exactly what to write, it makes it so much easier to target your results, all right? So let's go to the next step. So on the bottom part of the letter, we have the actual accounts that we are disputing. Take a look at the reason checklist. It says we need the action, justifier, reason, and outcome, right? So just as a side note there, I do have a video that's going to be linked at the very end of this video, and it's for the dispute letter magic, where we're going to go into the science behind each part of this formula, all right? And it actually resulted in over 20,000 deletions in 2020. So if you want to check that out, make sure you wait to the end of the video and click on it on the end screen. So let's go back to this. As you can see, just as the top part of the letter, we have things that are highlighted. So we need the action, justifier, reason, and outcome, right? So for capital one, we're saying delete for inaccuracy because the balance is reported as $22, $25, and $29. I mean, obviously those are three totally different numbers, right? And these are actual reasons taken directly from letters that I've sent out. These are not made up, okay? So delete for capital one is going to be our action. Because it's a justifier, the reason is balance is reported as 22, 25, and 29. Now, outcome is optional. Outcome, I normally only use outcome for late payments. And you're going to see that on the Discover account. So now we have an unknown collection and I'm seeing delete, which is the action for false reporting because the justifier, no furnisher name or address reports. And that is the reason. And you failed to correct this from my first dispute. That's everything that you need to write. There's no additional information that's required, okay? Discover, remove, that's the action, the late payment on June 2020 because justifier. It's reported as 30 days late, but Equifax and TransUnion both report that I paid on time. That's the reason. Update the status to reflect that I paid on time. That is the outcome. That's what I want them to do. I told them why I'm disputing it, what I want them to do, which is remove it, and what the outcome should be, that I want them to correct something, okay? Now, let's look at our last one, XYZ apartment collection 12345. Stop reporting, that's the action, this account because, that's a justifier, I disputed this on the date of my first dispute and the notice of dispute was not entered, that's my reason, within the 30-day time period. Delete for violation of section 623. Now, I did tell you that I was going to let you know one of my top three tactics for removing negative items, and that's a little bit of a hint right there, all right? So let's go to the next step. Now you see that we have met all the requirements for the reasons, the requirements for the opener, and let's check out the other things that you need to know about to get your results. Let's jump over to identification. With every single letter, every single time they go out the door, you should be sending a copy of your identification, license or military or passport, social security card or W-2 or something that has your full number listed on it, 12345678, right? And proof of address and know your identification, meaning your license, your state ID, your passport, whatever, that's not proof of address. A birth certificate cannot be used, all right? You're talking about utility bill or cell phone bill or pay stub or bank statement, whatever. Those are proof of address every single time, okay? I see this in the comments all the time. Do I have to send this out every single time? Yes, you do, my friend. Yes, you do, okay? Now, follow up. Every single time that you send out your next dispute, always make sure that you are checking for violations before you send out your letter, okay? Violations not in your letter, but you can use these when you're crafting your action plan because every single letter has its own action plan, right? Now, look at the response analysis. What is Experian or what is Equifax or what is TransUnion sending to you if they're sending anything? Are they saying that they're no longer going to reinvestigate? Are they saying that it's just verified? Are they saying that it's certified as accurate? What are they saying? Because you can use it in your letters when you're crafting your opener, right? or even your dispute reason. Now, report comparison. What that means is that you need to look at the original report versus your current new report before you write your disputes. The reason, and this is pretty straightforward, but the reason is, number one, you have to make sure that that account is still on the credit report, that it was not deleted. Number two, you're looking for violations. Like I said, it's the notice of dispute on there. Did they certify or verify it as accurate, but did not update the date last reported? Did they change or re-age the date of last activity? So on and so forth. You have to have this new information, right? And then that takes me to the next part. New information. What new information is on your credit report that can be used in your dispute letter? Because that is how you craft factual-based disputes, because you're taking the facts directly from your credit report. Now, method. This needs to go out regular mail or certified, but doesn't have to be certified. I mean, unless you want to spend $21 or more per round, completely up to you. It's not going to make it happen any quicker. I mean, you're paying the post office. You're not paying the bureaus to have a faster, you know, investigation, okay? It needs to be a custom letter. You need to be using factual reasons, and it needs to be consumer authentic if you are a business. Now, frequency. Normally, it's 30 days, right? But if you send something in the middle of the month, they can add 15 days for additional info. Don't send mid-month disputes for the same account, all right? 15 days for obviously what we're currently going through. Now, I know that this recently ended, but they are still taking that additional time, and they can take that additional time, and they're going to use it as an excuse for the second thing that we went over. All right. So always be aware of the timing. Okay. And then add 4 days for that mail sending. All right. And that's really useful if you are not sending out certified mail. Just count 4 days. They should have received the letter. Now you can start your counting. Now you know when to pull your next report. Now you know when to send your next round of disputes. All right. So do you have any questions about this? If you don't understand something, you don't understand how to do factual-based disputes, you don't understand what this checklist is for, you don't understand the 5-part, you know, formula, whatever it is, post it in the comments and I will answer it. I will help you with whatever it is. Okay. Now, as promised, this is one of my top 3 tactics or my secrets, and it's using the notice of dispute. So one of the fastest ways to get a deletion is to catch the credit bureaus and even collectors in a violation for failure to enter the required notice of dispute. So you see, if it's not reported on the account, like in the comment section within 30 days of receiving the first dispute, it's a violation. I mean, this is actually the magic behind the validation of debt method. Now, I have removed countless accounts just using this one violation. It is that important, okay? So always remember that you need to know your violations. And once you know your violations, once you know how an account should be reported, how it should not be reported, then you're putting yourself in the best possible place to get the maximum results in the least amount of time, all right? Now, if you want to learn more, if you want to reach out, then here are 2 very, very simple links. My740.com will take you to my booking page if you want to see if I can take over your file and do the credit sweep for you. Now, the second link, vault.my740.com, is actually where you can go to get access to the free subscriber hub and a bunch of other awesome resources, okay? So, anywho, now we are at the end of the video, and like I said, this is actually going to be where you can click on the dispute letter magic video, where we go into the science behind the 5-part formula that generated over 20,000 deletions last year. And make sure to hit that like and subscribe if you haven't done so, and I will see you next time. In today's video, we are going to go over what to do when the bureaus won't reinvestigate. And this is part 2. You see, we started a brand new FAQ series for credit sweeps. But instead of moving on to the next question, I'm going to give you concrete proof to show you exactly how to deal with this stall tactic. So you're going to see concrete evidence directly from Experian that proves they only take factual disputes seriously. And I'm going to show you exactly how to handle a refusal to investigate any future disputes. Now, these are 3 of the things, and only 3, that we are going to answer. Disputing a blank will change your dispute timing from 30 days the 45, a violation of Section 611 happens when the bureaus refuse to investigate a blank, and the credit bureaus must reinvestigate when you tell them blank, as required by law. Are you ready? Here we have a direct response from Experian where they're stating, we're not going to reinvestigate these accounts. And I actually had to go way back to 2015 to find this in my vault. So let's take a look and break this down. The first section is very, very clear. They reject you simply by stating that the credit granter has verified the accuracy of the account disputed. This is basically telling you that you've reached the end of the road and to go away. Now, Section 611 says they can reject your dispute if you submitted the same dispute. Like, for example, if you said it's unknown or unverified and then sent another dispute saying the same thing, they can reject this for that reason. However, my records show that back in 2015, each dispute letter for this client was factual and taken directly from his credit report, therein making the statement null and void. Now, what you should take away from this is that when you send a new and relevant dispute, they cannot reject based on Section 611 and must actually reinvestigate. Now, here's the proof that using factual disputes is the only way to beat this tactic. It says, if you have additional relevant information that was not presented when you previously disputed the information. In other words, when you send a new dispute reason that has never been used before, they will reinvestigate the disputed info. And here's the big kicker. When you send in templates, you're not specifying the reason the account is inaccurate. You're basically saying that something is unverified and they have to remove it. However, as you can see here, it says that when you tell them specifically why you believe this account or information is inaccurate, they process your dispute as required by law. Now, as I said, I've been searching for this info for years, and you know, I basically totally forgot where I found it, and here it is. The reason you don't want to dispute annual free credit report is because it turns your 30-day investigation into a 45-day investigation. So if you want faster results, make sure to stay away from free annual reports. And here's why so many companies con consumers into signing up. This says that if the bureaus don't receive a response from the furnisher or vendor within the required period, we update the item as you have requested or delete the information. What they're not saying is that the bureaus normally respond, and when they don't, it says they did in their system. And when the creditor or vendor catches up on their paperwork, they can reinsert the accounts even though they were previously deleted. Now, the second to last thing here is what I love about using factual disputes. It says that in some instances, upon reviewing your credit file and any relevant information you have submitted to us, we are able to determine whether the disputed information should be changed or deleted without having to contact the furnisher or the vendor. Imagine sending in a dispute that says this account is unknown, or this account is not mine, or the account is unverified. They will absolutely have to send it over to the furnisher to investigate. However, if you sent in a dispute that proves the balance is reported differently on all three bureaus, or that the required dispute is not entered within the required time frame, or something else that is factual and can be proven in a similar fashion, they can remove the account without contacting them. Which would you rather use? Now, here we're on the last statement that they want to drive home. Even though they already said it, unless you send us additional relevant information to support your claim, we will not reinvestigate this information again. So here's the question. What do we do when we receive one of these responses from the credit bureaus, and how can we try to prevent? See, now we're gonna answer that question right now. We've already proven that disputing a free annual credit report will change your dispute timing from 30 days to 45 days, and a violation of Section 611 happens when the bureaus refuse to investigate a duplicate dispute or a same dispute, and the credit bureaus must reinvestigate when you tell them specifically why you believe the information is inaccurate as required by law. So here's the solution, and this is the proactive solution. Now, with your credit report, I recommend one place to consistently pull your report, and I actually use IdentityIQ for my clients, and you can find a discounted link in the description. Don't give the bureaus an additional 15 days just because you want a free annual report. Now, your letter should only state why you're writing it, what you want them to do, what you're disputing, and why you're disputing it. That's it. As far as your reason, the dispute reason should specifically state which element is inaccurate, what you want them to do about it, why it's inaccurate, and what the outcome should be. And that's optional, more for late payments. Now, if this does happen to you, you obviously have to handle this reactively. Now, with Section 611, you can state that they are in violation for refusing to reinvestigate a new factual dispute. And this is the beauty of factual-based dispute systems because your next dispute is always the next best reason taken directly from the credit report. So that's additional relevant information not having have previously been disputed. Excuse me. Now, my recommendation is to use these arguments in your initial paragraph instead of the actual dispute reason because this is going to save you from spinning in circles with the bureaus. So if you want to see this in action, your paragraph one of your letter can basically say, I'm submitting new and relevant information and requesting a reinvestigation of the following accounts per Section 611. And now your dispute reasons, not on your first one, but your second dispute could be delete this account because I disputed it on date and you did not enter the required notice of dispute by date plus 30, which is a violation of Section 623. Or delete this account because Experian shows a balance of zero, Equifax 2008, and TransUnion 522. As you can see, both of these are specific and factual. So that is how you would handle it reactively. Now, how can you use this to increase your results? I want for you to click on the link in the description to get to this page, the entire presentation actually, and I want you to write down how you can use this solution to optimize your dispute strategy proactively, and how you can increase your chances of deletions or corrections using this solution reactively. Okay. Now, what we went over today was how to handle this when it's verified as accurate, and how to deal with the no reinvestigation, and two different solutions using proactive and reactive approaches. Now, you can check out the next video, which is the six-part dispute letter checklist, if you haven't done so already. And it basically is going to help you optimize your results using this checklist. That link is also in the description, and I'm probably going to tag this on the end screen. Now that we are at the end and we've done our recap, I want to let you know that you can actually go to vault.my740.com and access a ton of awesome free content in the member vault on the subscribers hub. This will help you learn how to do factual-based disputes, or if this is just not something that you want to do yourself, that's totally cool. You can go to my740.com and schedule a call with me, and I will see if I can help. So that is it for today. Make sure to click on one of the other videos, including the six-part dispute letter checklist that's going to help you increase. In today's video, we are going over 41 challenges and violations, and it breaks down to 19 things you can dispute on an account, 11 credit bureau violations, and 11 creditor violations. We're starting with the problem, then I'm going to give you the dispute reasons, the bureau violations, creditor violations, and lastly, a quiz because I want to make sure that you understand this so that you can capitalize and get your results. So I'm going to show you what can easily be disputed on your credit report, how to spot the violations, and like I said, we are going to also have a quiz. All right, so here is the problem. It has always been my professional and tested opinion that the biggest problem is understanding the difference between methods that put a temporary band-aid on and one that gets permanent fixes, right? You see, we don't want to use vague general disputes because, yeah, they can get results, but they're normally added back to the credit report quickly. And we don't want that. We do not want that. Do you really want to be checking your credit report every 5 days? And then questioning the existence of an account might actually be very easy for the bureaus or the furnisher to prove. So you don't want to make their job easier for them. And using the same dispute reason each time, like unverified, can get results, but you're more than likely to get a rejection for further investigation. And you can check out the description for the videos on this where I break down why this happens and how to get around this, okay? You wanna beat the system. We're not trying to fool it, we're trying to beat it and get results. And then a one-size-fits-all type of deal for disputes, it normally gets a response that says verified as accurate with no actual investigation, all right? So here's the solution, and it's the only solution. and I am very adamant about this, factual-based disputes. Challenging other sections of the reporting can prove to be more difficult because, again, we're not making their job easy for the bureaus and furnishers than dealing with the general statements they normally get. What is so special about your disputes? If you can't really answer that, then you're not disputing the right way, okay? This is what I've been doing for each of my clients for 6.5 years and what resulted in over 20,000 deletions in 2020 alone, okay? So now when you're constructing your disputes, my recommendation is keep it real. You can take this with a grain of salt or you can etch it in your Bible, it's up to you. But my recommendation is always to keep your disputes factual. And here's the deal. Factual doesn't mean that it's valid, true, verified, yours, or anything similar. Factual means that you're not trying to flam the bureaus with general disputes, lies, or anything else. Our job is to get legal, permanent results, and the highest scores possible. Well, this is how I do it. My letters include facts, and the info is taken directly from the client's credit report. And when I construct their disputes, I follow very specific formulas. And again, you could find those videos linked in the description. So let's take a look at 19 things that you can check, and these are dispute elements per each account, okay? And some of these may look very, very familiar. So the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to check for blatant inaccuracies. And that doesn't always mean that you have three different balances or, you know, three different past dues or just dates that don't make sense. It's little things that you know to be inaccurate before you ever compare bureaus, okay? So just for an example, is the account number correct? The date the account was established? The high balance? The credit limit? The terms? The frequency of payments? Status? Balance? Past due balance? Should there be a past due balance at all? What about the date last payment? What about the payment amount? First delinquency? Is it reflecting as a charge-off correctly or incorrectly? What about the charge-off amount, the date close, type of account, responsibility section, like where it says it's authorized user, individual? What about the additional information section? Was the date last, was the notice of dispute entered? Does it say that it was disputed by consumer? Anything that is very similar to that, okay? If not, then you need to use these and capitalize to get your results. Okay, so here are your next steps. So this is what you do with this information. So this is actually where so many consumers get stuck. Let's say that you found something inaccurate on your account. Now what? I'd actually recommend checking out the videos and resources linked in the description to learn more on how to construct your disputes, the 5-part formula generated over 20,000 plus deletions in 2020, how to write your letters to get maximum results, and how to virtually remove any negative item from your credit report. So let's get to the violations. We are going over the credit bureau violations, and there are 11 of them. All right, willfully and recklessly reporting false info after being notified of the reporting error and failing to investigate or correct the error. And this does include mixed files, inaccurate data status or last activity, inaccurate balance, inaccurate remarks, reinserting or re-reporting a previously deleted item without notifying you within writing within 5 business days of the reinsertion, failure to respond to a dispute within 30 days or 45 days for free annual report, and just a side note here, they can add 15 days in some cases where the creditor or the consumer has provided additional info applicable to the dispute. Reporting a bankruptcy longer than 10 years from the date of adjudication. Reporting a paid tax lien longer than 7 years, and just so you know, if it's unpaid, it can be 10. Failing to update or report the status and or balance of the account that was included in bankruptcy as discharged with the zero balance. Failing to provide, if requested after verification, the method of verification, including the real name, address and phone number of the furnisher within 15 days of your request, reporting a collection or charge off longer than 7 years from the date of status or last activity, and just so you know, there are exceptions of credit transactions involving more than $150,000, the underwriting of life insurance involving over $150,000, or employment with an annual salary reasonably expected to exceed $75,000 a year. All right, we have a couple of more. Failing to notate that an item on your credit report is under dispute, in other words, notice of dispute, and we just talked about that. And yes, I see that typo right there. Reporting a record of arrest or conviction longer than 7 years, and failure to provide all relevant info to the furnisher when reasonable means to do so are available. Now, let's check out creditor violations, and some of these may look very, very, very familiar. All right. Ignoring an investigation request. And here we go again, willfully and recklessly reporting false info to the credit bureaus after being notified of the reporting error and failing to investigate or correct the error. And again, this includes mixed files, inaccurate data status or last activity, inaccurate balance, and inaccurate remarks. Reporting a charge-off account without reference to the date of status or last activity, and failure to report an account disputed by the consumer as disputed to the credit bureaus. And we got some more here. Transferring or selling an account to another company without reporting the transfer and or zero balance. I see this one all the time. Failing to update the status and or balance of an account that was included in bankruptcy as discharged with a zero balance. Falsely reporting the ownership of an account to a non-liable consumer like the spouse, family member, etc. And withholding account data with intent to negatively affect a consumer's credit score. Okay, like the credit limit. I see this all the time with Capital One and Barclays. And guess what? Capital One admitted in testimony during a lawsuit that they do this purposely. Okay, so this is where you're going to see it say high balance is credit limit or credit limit is high balance or anything to that effect. The credit limit should be the credit limit. If the credit limit is $2,500, but the high balance is only $200, that's much different than it saying that the credit limit is the high balance, because the high balance, if it was only $200, that's way less than $2,500. So that means that they're screwing with the utilization. That's why it's so important to understand these things, okay? Failing to delete a hard inquiry that had no permissible purpose, and you can go check out my free inquiry removal webinar that was posted within the last 60 days right here on YouTube. And just so you know, permissible purpose does not mean that they just got shotgunned your application for a dealership, for a vehicle, and that you didn't, get a firm offer, okay? So it's either a firm offer of credit, employment, insurance, court order, child support, things like that. If it does not fall into any of those categories, then it does not belong on your credit report, okay? Reporting a new duplicate account after receiving notice of dispute on the old account. Reporting an account with false reference or without reference to the original creditor and or the account number. Okay, we are on the quiz section. I want to make sure that these things stay in your head. We are doing some true or false. So true or false. It is a violation to willfully and recklessly report inaccurate date last active after being notified of the reporting error and failing to investigate or correct the error. The correct answer, of course, it is true. It is most definitely a violation, okay? Question number two, true or false? Questioning the existence of an account is hard for the credit bureaus to prove and should be used first. The correct answer, please tell me you know the correct answer. The correct answer is false. It is not hard. It is super easy for them, and that is definitely not what you should be doing, and most definitely not first, okay? Question number three, true or false? It is not a violation to fail to report the account as disputed to the credit bureaus. The wrong answer is true. Okay, it is a violation to fail to report the account as disputed to the credit bureaus pursuant to section 623. All accounts should be reported as disputed within 30 days of the date that they received your first dispute. True or false? We have 19 account elements to check out for inaccuracies before we ever even talk about inconsistencies between the bureaus. The correct answer is true. We most definitely have 19 account elements to check out. That's where we were going over, is the status correct, the date last active, the past due amount. All right. Question number five, true or false? It's best to use factual disputes because it is targeted, strategic, and tactical. There's no one size fits all. The wrong answer to this is false. Why is it false? Because it is best to use factual disputes because it's targeted, strategic, and tactical, okay? So don't fall into this whole perpetual cycle just because you're using the wrong methods, okay? Now, here are some resources for you, all right? You can continue to do this yourself, and I give you a ton of resources. Down in the description, you get access a bunch of videos that go with this video to give you more of a breakdown and understanding, or you can go check out the free subscriber hub at vault.my740.com, and there's downloads, apps, a bunch of stuff, right? And, I mean, alternately, you can actually have me do it for you if I can help, if it would be a good fit. And to find out if it would be a good fit, just go to my740.com, schedule a call, and I will see if I can help, all right? Now, lastly, I have a new podcast coming out. I will post the link when it is available because I am switching platforms. So, I mean, the bottom line here is that everything you need is just one click away, whether that means doing it yourself or having me do it for you. So thanks for watching. Make sure to like, comment, and subscribe. I will see you tomorrow for another daily video. And if you like this video, please smash that like. And if you are subscribed but haven't, smashed the bell for notifications yet, make sure you do so, because otherwise you won't be notified of videos just like this. So that was 41 challenges and violations, 19 dispute reasons or dispute elements that you can check out, 11 creditor violations, and 11 credit bureau violations, all right? So I hope you have a wonderful day. Make sure to go down into the description, click on those links so that you can use this to capitalize and get those results. Have a great one. Today we are going over 5 different ways to write a dispute reason for the same account type. Now, you might have multiple collections or multiple charge-offs or multiple accounts that have late payments, and you don't want to use the same thing every single time. Date last active on this one, date last active on this one, date last active on this one, date last active on this one. But if you want to stay at the top of the hierarchy in the pyramid, you kind of want to use this information. So I'm going to show you exactly how to do this so that it does not come back as frivolous. All right. So going across left to right, at the top, we have charge-offs, and left to right on the bottom, we have collections. So let's check this out. Charge-off example 1, and we're using the dispute element date last active. You've reported different dates under the date of last activity. Enter your dates there. Stop reporting due to FCRA non-compliance of inaccurate data being furnished on the consumer report. Charge-off example 2, using date last active. Inaccurate data is being furnished, and this account needs to stop reporting for FCRA non-compliance. You see how it's the same language, but not? There are different dates last active reported, and this is where you put your dates. How can there be different dates when this is what stipulates when the account naturally falls off? You can't report different months and different years. Okay, so we're saying the same thing, but we're not. So yes, you are still going to want to use the 5-part formula for a dispute reason, but I'm just trying to show you that you don't have to say the exact same thing every single time, even though you want to use the same dispute reason type. Charge-off example 3, date last active. I would like for you to remove this account because the dates are completely different when I look at the dates and the date of last activity. See how many times I use the date there? Now, this is where you're going to put the actual dates. I know that it's supposed to be the same date. Inaccurate data is being furnished and this account needs to stop reporting for FCRA non-compliance. Now, some of these are a little bit longer and that's okay, but the only reason that I'm showing it to you like this is just to give you an idea of how you can write your reasons differently. Were we on 3? Nope, we are on 4. Using the element date last paid. Date last paid shows multiple dates and this makes it look like I paid when I didn't and didn't when I paid. How is that possible? How can there be years between bureaus, meaning different years? Inaccurate data is being furnished, blah, blah, blah. In other words, delete the damn thing, right? All right, so charge-off example 5, using first date of delinquency. Account has the date of first delinquency reported inaccurately, and this means that the entire account must be removed for inaccuracy, okay? So there's different ways that you can dispute the same thing. These are all for charge-offs. Now let's take a look at collections, right? And this is using the dispute reason that the account is either unknown or unverified, and this is very straightforward. I don't know what this is. Please remove this unverified account unless you can furnish a signed contract. And here is example 2. Using the dispute reason that the account is either unknown or unverified, delete this account because you cannot furnish any documentation that would verify ownership. Remove this unverified account. Okay, so now we're talking about debt buyers. The other one would be used for utility medical, so on and so forth. All right. So date last paid shows multiple dates, and this makes it look like I paid when I didn't and didn't when I paid. Doesn't that sound familiar? That's because this is an example of using non-collection dispute reasons for collections. So it doesn't have to be specifically for a collection. It just needs to be something that's going to target the account and get the account removed, okay? And here's another one for an account such as portfolio recovery. Delete this account because the collection is past due by default and therefore cannot report a past due. It's actually a violation. Here's another one for an account such as portfolio recovery. Delete this account for violation because it reports late payments in the payment history, even though it's a collection. All right. So don't fret, don't freak out, don't blow your head off when you have multiple of the same account. Charge off, charge off, charge off, charge off, charge off, collection, 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 collection. All you have to do is find the thing that's going to give the biggest impact and the best possible chance of removal for that account, and then write your reasons so that they are just different. They're just different, okay? I just don't want for you to write, remove this account or delete this account because the date last active is inaccurate. Date, 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 date. Delete this account because the account, the date last active is inaccurate. Delete, 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 blah, blah. Delete this account because the date last paid is inaccurate. Date, date, date. Delete this account because the date last paid is inaccurate. Date, date, date. You can't do that, okay? So what I want for you to do is go click on the link, check this out yourself, and start thinking about how you can change up the wording for your disputes when you have the same account type, all right? So if you have questions about this, very simply, post a comment, let me know. Post a comment anyways, and let me know what you're struggling with, because that means that I can create content that is going to help you, all right? So for right now, I hope you have a wonderful day. I will see you for another daily video tomorrow, and make sure to like this video, comment as I mentioned, share it with someone who might need it more than you, and I will see you tomorrow. Have a great one. Hey, we are back with another client win video. I'm sharing this client with you who jumped 132 points with their credit score in just 60 days. Now, is that going to happen with everyone? Absolutely not. And if anyone tells you otherwise, they are 300% BSing you. Now, I'm never going to do that, but I do want to inspire you, give you hope, and make sure that you don't get frustrated and give up and let them win. You see, when this client signed up in February, they had no Equifax score, a 474 on Experian, and a 481 on TransUnion. However, two rounds later, now we have a 613 finally on Equifax, a 606 on Experian, and a 590 on TransUnion. Take a look at the actual reports. So these are the current scores, 590, 606, and 613. And here is the report originally. There you go, 481, 474, and absolutely no Equifax score. So if you are currently struggling, number one, post in the comments and let me know what you're struggling with so that I can either create a video or, you know, figure out how else I can help you. And check out the free resources at vault.my740.com. Or if this is something where you want me to do it for you, very simply go to my740.com, schedule a call with me, and I will see if I can help. That is it for today. I will see you tomorrow for another daily video. And make sure to comment on this video, like it, subscribe if you haven't done so, and share it with a friend. I'll see you tomorrow. Today, I'm going to show you a super simple systematic flow that you can use to take the information from your credit report and turn it into disputes that get results. And this is even if you've never done this before. So the first thing we want to do is figure out what it is that we need to dispute. So we are first going to do a credit report analysis. Now, pausing right there real quick, I have my clients use Identity IQ. You can use whatever you want, and you can take this with a grain of salt or etch it in your Bible. It's completely up to you. But my recommendation is to use Identity IQ, or you can even use Smart Credit. Now, I only use Identity IQ for my clients, but it's very simply because it shows me the information I need that's going to be at the top of the hierarchy in the pyramid method, such as date last active, date last paid, date last reported, so on and so forth. And those are the things that are going to remove charge-offs, collections, foreclosures, repossessions, all those things that really, really, really drop your credit score, right? Now, if you want to get access to Identity IQ, all three reports and scores, but you don't want to pay their full price, use my discounted link down in the description. So let's move forward. We're going to do our credit report analysis. And for this example, we have one medical collection that is unknown, another medical collection for $50, a K Jewelers charge off for $100, credit acceptance repo for $16,000, and an apartment eviction under public records for $3,000, and a late payment on American Express, and the account was closed, zero balance. Now, what we need to do is figure out, number one, what's hurting me the most, number two, what's kind of like mid, and number three, what is the least impactful to my credit score. And we do this very, very simply. So, using this example, we have K Jewelers, the charge-off, the eviction, and the repo. Those are most hurtful to my credit score. The mid is just the late payment, and the least is going to be obviously those two medical collections. Now, you also need to have a goal for your credit score. So in this example, we have a 500 on Experian, 496 on TransUnion, and a 505 on Equifax. My goal is to increase at least 140 points. So I want to get to a 640 on all three bureaus, all right? So now we know what's hurting the most, mid and least. Now I want to put down my goals in writing, okay? I want to remove this eviction, repo, and charge off in less than 9 months. And in less than 6 months, I want to get rid of the late payment. And in less than 4 months, I want to get rid of those collections. And then as I mentioned, in the next 12 months, I want to raise my score at least 140 points. So now that we have our action plan, our analysis, and our goals, we need to figure out what inaccuracies we can use taken directly from those accounts on the credit report to put in our disputes. So what I did was I created our inaccuracies. The medical collection, that one's really simple. I already told you I don't know it, so it's unverifiable. The next one, I'm just gonna use the validation of debt method directly with the collector and with the bureaus. I'm first gonna tell them that it's unknown. Now, with K Jewelers, I'm noticing that there are three different dates last active, and in those dates, there's two different years. You know that's not possible. The apartment eviction, the balance is zero on TransUnion, and the other two have it as 3,000. For the repo, the high balance is lower than the balance. That is not possible because the high balance means it is the highest balance the account has ever had. That's actually a violation. Anywho, the late payment on American Express is reported differently in all three bureaus. Equifax reports it on time, and TransUnion is June 2020, and Experian shows May 2020. So now what I need to do is I need to take all this information and create my dispute in my letter planning. You see, what I do is I like to have everything in pieces, make sure that these pieces make sense, and then put them all together when I'm using a system like this. But it works. It works when you're breaking it down backwards, and it works when you're putting it together for your planner, okay? So our very first sentence is really, really simple. The opening of this is, please remove these inaccurate accounts from my credit report. Send me a new credit report reflecting these changes. So I have my opener. Now I took those accounts plus those dispute reasons and I put them together and placed them under that paragraph. As you can see, it says K Jewelers account number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Delete this account because three different dates last active report as date, date, and date. You see what I'm saying? The first thing that I showed you was that we have these multiple accounts to remove. And then after we did our action plan, I showed you the inaccuracies. So all I did was I took those inaccuracies for that account and I put it together. And that would be my creditor name, account number, and dispute reason. All right, so let's go to the next one. Credit acceptance, account number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Delete this account because the high balance is lower than the balance. Super simple, right? Apartment eviction, D12345. Delete for inaccuracy because the balance is zero on TransUnion, and then Experian and Equifax show 3,000. Now, with American Express account number 12345, it says remove the late payment for inaccuracy because TU, TransUnion, reports June 2020 late, Experian reports May 2020 late, and Equifax reports accurately that I paid on time. Now, regardless of whether I was late or not, I'm using Equifax to basically say, as you can see, that I paid on time. Here's the proof, I paid on time. So you need to remove yours from my credit report. You see how that works? Now, medical collection 12345, this account is unknown and needs to be deleted from my credit report. Medical collection 12345B, I don't know what this is.
Delete this unverifiable account. Thank you, your name. So the very next step to this would be pretty obvious. It would be taking it from this page, putting it onto some sort of document processor such as Word or Notepad, and then sending it out into the mail. So let's recap real quick. We first pull our credit report and figure out what needs to be disputed. Then we look at what is hurting us the most. Then we create our goals and look at our credit scores. Then we find our inaccuracies, and then we put it all together. Now, I'm going to be doing a virtual workshop where I go way more into depth how you can take your accounts and figure out exactly what you need to do by breaking this all down and then putting it together. You see, none of this needs to be difficult. And sometimes it may seem too difficult to even want to take on, right? But I'm going to show you exactly how you can use this systematic flow to make very, very effective disputes that get results. So for right now, that is it in this video. I will see you later or tomorrow for another daily video. And if you need help, not for the workshop because I haven't come out with that yet, but if you need help, you want to see if I can take over your file and do the credit sweep for you, very simply, go down into the description, click on the link, and go to my740.com and schedule a call with me, and I will see if I can help. Now, if you want to continue on with the do-it-yourself method, there's nothing wrong with that. I have a ton of free resources in addition to the 500 videos right here on YouTube. Go and check out the Vault, okay? The subscriber hub on the Vault at vault.my740.com is going to give you a ton of free stuff, okay? So go check that out, but otherwise, I will see you later. Post a comment on this video letting me know what you are currently struggling with. Like this video, share it with someone who might need it, and I will see you later. Subscribe if you haven't done so yet. All right, bye.